So welcome. It's my turn to welcome you all today here. And what an amazing place to talk about innovation, having London as a bedrock. So please enjoy the day. So I used to be a vet long time ago. Now I can say what's the difference between a cat and a dog, and that's it. But I thought to make the connection with the audience, I thought perhaps to share a story from my days that I used to work as a vet, in order then to talk about the future, and also to explain the title of my presentation. So this is the story. Back in 2000, I used to work as a vet, you know, and I'm going to talk to you about this day that I will remember forever. You know, a routine day, you know, normal kind of schedule, routine operations, and a couple of, routine consultations. And then suddenly, a poor guy comes into our doorstep with a small bat, you know, those black creatures that fly around the night and petrify us, with a broken wing. And we were like, what the hell can we do with that? We didn't have the knowledge, we didn't have the technology, but we had to do something. So we improvised, and you know, to cut a long story short, 2 hours down the line, we had a happy customer and then a happy animal. But then, with my kind of academic hat, I think this type of incremental innovation, so to speak, was a way to go back in 2000. But if we come to, you know, in our days, this type of thinking about innovation is not enough. So, you know, I'm privileged enough to have a job that allows me to travel the world, to work with different organizations around the globe. But wherever I go, the same realization hits me that we tend to think about innovation the way that we did 20 years ago. But as Richard has already demonstrated, you know, the world is changing, and it's changing really fast. Hence, we have to think about innovation in a different way. Hence, the topic, the title of my topic. So I'll try to kind of share with you my thinking about how the profession can think about innovation in somehow different ways, sharing some kind of best practices from other industries. So I have a question for you. It's a very simple question, so I expect a simple answer. Performance and health. Which do you think is the most important role here? Someone said health, of course. Anybody else?
I agree, health.
Okay. Thank you. I'm going to talk to you about the magic of ANT. And in many organizations, people are frustrated to think about either or options. Can we improve customer services? Or can we reduce costs? Can we do both? Let me give you another example. The constant paradox between speed and stability. Yes? So think about this type of organization that has the high metabolic rate, quick decision making, as opposed to a stable organization. And think about these spikes. They reach stability with a certain speed, too slow and they fall off, too fast, they spin out of control. But you make it perfect. At the right speed, you have the perfect spinning bike. So I think, incidentally, we can use metaphors and analogy to talk about innovation. So I think, you know, the perfect innovative company needs to think about innovation in both incremental and disruptive terms. But it's very difficult to keep the balance, and I'll share with you why I think it's very difficult to keep the balance. But first, let me, for those of you who might not understand the concept of disruption or disruptive innovation, let me tell you what it means, and then I'll take you further. So Christensen, who coined the term disruptive innovation, suggests that most companies tend to spend too much time, energy, power, resources on improving incrementally their services that they offer towards the high end of the market. And that makes sense because this is the greater ability to pay. But as a result of that, there is a massive space here at the, you know, low end of the market that these people don't pay too much attention. So new entrants can come in, use technology in a different way, in different ways, in a radical way, to cover demand here in a kind of uninteractive way, because they are not interested in what goes here, what goes on here. And then these guys slowly build capability that can become mainstream and then can come and disrupt the market. Kodak, do you remember the brand? I imagine yes. Where are they now? Nokia. How many of you used to have a Nokia analog mobile phone? What happened to them? They disappeared. Blockbusters. Do we remember them? Yeah? They're out of the game. All these companies were very good companies. They didn't disappear because they were bad companies. They disappeared because they didn't pay attention. What over here, what happened, you know, below them? Yeah? But I think it's very difficult. It's very difficult to keep the balance between thinking about innovation in incremental terms, but also think about innovation in disruptive terms. And I think that the reason for that is that it's because the way we think about innovation in financial and measurement terms. And let me explain. So the way, the value that leaders add to their organization as they face more and more uncertainty. So if we place uncertainty down here, and the more uncertainty grows, so the value that people place in the organization is less about what we call measurable present value or return on investment considerations, and it's more on what we call option value. And it's an easy term to conceptualize, option value. If I make an investment today, small investment today, that gives me the right, but not the obligation, to invest in the future. It's a simple term. The problem is, though, that every time human beings, every time we think about making an investment, our reflexes takes us down here. How much will it cost me, of course. Instead, we should be thinking, if I'm making this investment today, what are the vectors of opportunities that will be opened up to me in the future to scale this up, to create new possibilities, to create new futures? But, you know, if you think about this has really implications in terms of the innovation portfolio of every organization. So if we build on this notion of uncertainty and play with an innovation portfolio, which we're going to do in a minute, we need to place different emphasis in different options or different projects available to us. So let's play with a innovation portfolio. So if we play with two different dimensions of uncertainty. Uncertainty about markets, and here, and we can think about markets in the simple possible way, our customers, yes? And if we create a service, are they gonna buy, or a product, are they gonna buy? How much do we need to sell it for? for break even. Yeah, uncertainty about markets. And then on the vertical box, we can talk about uncertainty about technology. Can we do it? We have a vision. Yes, can we do it? Is it safe? Will it pass the regulatory framework? So if we play with these dimensions of uncertainty, we can think about innovation options in very different, in many and very different terms. So the easiest and the first option available to us is what we call core innovations. These are the products and services that our customers know us for, yes? And obviously, we need to be very good at these services, and we need to find the resources to produce these services or products. Otherwise, we cannot exist, okay? Down here, we need to be able to incrementally improve our offerings. So we need to make our services, you know, faster, cheaper, better, our products, so that we can maintain our competitive advantage. So incremental innovation is important. I'm not saying that's not important. Of course, to keep a healthy innovation portfolio, we also need to think. Let me ask you something. When we think about innovation, what comes the first thing that comes to mind? Your mind. What do you think is innovation? I'm asking. New. New ideas. Yes? Anything else? Change? Yes? Anything else? Improvement? Yes, all this nice work. Anything else? That's all very important, but we always ignore the fact that removing waste is also innovation. Removing the slow growth areas from our portfolio is also innovation. There is great appetite to think about creating new services, new ideas, but we forget to focus on our attention on what's happening to those aspects of our portfolio that do not help us to, you know, slow growth areas that cannot help us to achieve our strategic objectives. So within the core innovation options, we need to improve fast. We need to make our services faster, cheaper, better. Yeah? And also think about how we can cannibalize, disinvest our portfolio to keep our offerings healthy. Yeah? So I think that's always easy to do. And most organizations do that. Yes? They spend, as I said earlier, most of the time, appetite, power, resources to incrementally improve their offerings. The implication of that is that I'm arguing that there are at least two other options that every single organization should look into it in order to keep a healthy innovation portfolio. The first one is what we call new platforms. And I think it's not difficult to understand what this refers to. We know that there is an appetite for it. Our customers will buy it. But, you know, we don't know whether we can do it. There is uncertainty over here. This has simply to do with introduction of, you know, new technologies into existing services. Yes? These are usually candidates that can become candidates of innovation that can become part of the core innovation offering. It's not that difficult to put into the market. And I think Apple is a very good example. The way that they moved from the iPod to the iPad, that's what they did. You know, they keep adding new technologies into existing offerings. Yeah. Now the other option available to us is, again, same segment of the market, same customer. We know that there is an appetite for a service. The problem is that we don't know whether we can make it. Yeah? This is position option. So we increase the uncertainty in terms of capabilities and technologies, but we think about the same type of customer, the same market segment. I think here the rules of the game is improve services fast, make services fast, cheap, better. Over here, the rules of the game change, and this has implications for our leadership approach, our culture. Here, the rules of the games are fail fast, fail cheap. Learn fast, learn cheap, yes? So the next kind of option is, we know we have the know-how, we don't know whether there is demand on the market. Tesla, do we know Tesla? Tesla is a key player in the automobile area, but then again, some of us may be surprised when they recently launched their product in the solar panel energy production. Different market, same technology. Same applies to Google. Google is a search, operates in the search field, yet again, they offer different innovation products in different areas. Again, uncertainty, great level of uncertainty. So the same rule applies here. Fail fast, fail cheap. Yes? Failure here can be very costly for our brand, for our organization. Think about Samsung S7, Volkswagen, for example, yes? And of course, stepping stone option is perhaps the kind of the riskiest option available to us because we don't know whether we can do it. We don't know whether there will be demand. And it's easier for someone like me, being a researcher, to talk about it, but you know, someone with resource allocation opportunities, this is a head scratcher. But you know, but the actual name of it, I think the point here is to look into different areas, different ways to create different systems. And examples here that are available to us. Think about nanotechnology. Where do we use nanotechnology these days? Marginal use, yes? But we're talking about agriculture, medical devices at nanoscale. Yeah, that's pretty exciting. The same applies to artificial intelligence. It started already to disrupt workplaces. Another example is 3D printing. Yes? All these different technologies can disrupt the way that we do things. And here is a kind of an example of an innovation portfolio of a healthy, innovative company. Yes, the focus is here, but we try to kind of create our future. In essence, we try to disrupt what we do. And I think there are transferable lessons for the veterinary profession and any profession. Start with, I think what I'm trying to say here is we need to think about market leadership. And in the 90s and 80s, incremental innovation was by far the way to do it. But because we live in a very different world, digital age, knowledge economy, technological advances, we cannot ignore the value of disruptive innovation. So what I'm saying is we need to kind of think synergistically about incremental and disruptive radical innovation. We used to talk about disruptive innovation. Now we live in it every day. Examples of companies that managed to disrupt well-established fields. And I also already talked about the Kodaks, the Nokias, and so forth. And I think that disruption has already started with the veterinary profession. but we cannot see it because perhaps it's in the early stages. If I can go back to the disruption of innovation graph, you remember what we said, that disruption usually starts, but nobody notices it, yes? Because it starts from the low end of the market. So I think I like this phrase. If we do not disrupt ourselves, others will do it for us. So I think the lesson here is that, you know, we need to put ourselves in the comfortable position to disrupt the way that we do things. Because if we don't do it, others will do it for us. And I would like to kind of wrap up my talk with a recent example of what might be an amazing disruptive innovation. How many of you have heard of Wow Air? Okay. What are they doing? I think this guy, which I cannot pronounce his name, I think his vision is to pay customers to fly. Yes? Because he thinks that he can make more money out of customers through ancillary revenues, the, you know, parallel services available to customers at the point where they are on their airplane. So what they're trying to do, they're trying to exploit the business ecosystem, whatever comes with the passenger from the point they are on the aircraft. Nobody's bothering with them. Yes, they're a low budget airline. Big guys, they don't really think that they have the know-how to threaten their market share. But imagine what might happen if they you know, succeed and enact their vision to pay us to travel. I would travel with them. Would you? So I think this is how disruptive innovation works. It's happening, but we don't tend to realize until it really hurts. So on this note, I would like to thank you, and I wish you enjoy the rest of the day.